Melee builds in Fallout 4 can be a hit-or-miss kind of thing. You either like them, or you hate them. For me, I'm somewhere in the middle. Some of the melee weapons can be incredibly good, like the Super Sludge, or some of them can be horrifically bad, like the Pool Cue. So let's just get into it and see how bad I'm gonna want to die. Can you beat Fallout 4 using only the Pool Cue? Let's go over the rules real quick. 1. I can only use the Pool Cue to attack enemies, and I am not allowing myself to use Yao Guai Roast to buff my damage, mainly because it doesn't seem to work with the unofficial Fallout 4 patch. 2. I am also not allowed to wear power armor, as I imagine it would be a little too easy. That's it for the rules. It's also set to very hard. Ready? Let's go. As usual, we start with the character creation. I made my character have as round of a head as I could make it, and then I waited for the Vault-Tec representative to show up at my door. With this character, I tried to go for a pool hustler style, so I named him Q-Ball and gave him decent strength, charisma, and luck. Boom, bombs fell. Into the vault. Cryostasis. Wife died. Son kidnapped. Cryostasis again. Wake up. In that order. As with most specific weapons only run, I can't kill the rad roaches in the vault, so I had to trap them behind the doors so I could grab the Pip-Boy and make my leave. So, pool cues are a pretty common weapon early in the game, used mostly by raiders. That meant that I would most likely have to get one from a dead raider, but since I can't kill them without a pool cue, I was at an impasse. I figured that Preston Garvey could make himself useful for once, so I went to Concord and got ready to watch Preston kill a bunch of raiders, which took a lot less time than I expected it to. Sadly, there was no pool cue in sight. I reloaded a save in case the raiders would spawn in with different weapons, but that was a no-go either. So I reloaded again and ignored Concord for now. With not too many options left, I took to the Fallout Wiki and found a somewhat suitable location that had a pool cue. It was located at Natick Banks, which was a ways south from where I was. Thankfully, I was only attacked by dogs on the way there, and not something worse. When I arrived, I saw that the outlying area was chock full of raiders, so I bolted upstairs and found a pool cue, and then I ran as fast as I could so I could fast travel back to Sanctuary. The base damage of the pool cue is 22. I can increase it to 27 with the sharp modification, and that also gave it a bit of bleeding damage, which would be handy. Still, it's absolute garbage. It swings so slowly, and I can't increase that. This was already looking to be a tough run. I was now prepared to somewhat deal with the raiders at Concord, so I walked on over and let the pain commence. It's not the worst thing ever, but the speed of my attacks is what really got me. I died a few times to the basic raiders until I was lucky enough to succeed. I leveled up to 2 here and picked the Big League's perk for extra melee damage. Inside of the museum, there were more raiders. I dealt with them as swiftly as I could and made my way to Preston. It was now time for the real test of the Pool Cue's power. It was time to kill a Deathclaw. I can't use the power armor or the minigun, so I ignored them and jumped off the roof ready to face both man and beast. Raiders, simple enough. Even leveled me up to 3 so I could get more strength. Deathclaw, not as simple, but I also fought it in an incredibly cheeky way, so it was doable at least. You know, after a few deaths and some of Preston's help. With that done, the Minutemen could go to Sanctuary, and so could I. I didn't do anything there except level up and be angry that I didn't pick the armor perk so I could max up my raider armor, but what are you gonna do? With about as good equipment as I could get right now, I decided to head to Diamond City so I could buy some chems, which would be a staple in this run for extra damage, health, and resistances. On the way to Diamond City, I fought some mole rats, ran into Grey Garden, which would be a handy fast travel point later on, and killed some ghouls for the heck of it. I also slapped Piper upside the head with a pool cue because I know some of you have been waiting for it. Here I sold a lot of ammo to Solomon so I could buy his chems and stim packs, and then I left to find Good Neighbor, which gets easier and easier every time. Except for the Raider Scaver, who beat me to death with a pool cue. That was supposed to be you, asshole. At Good Neighbor, I convinced Finn to back off, talked to Cleo for no reason, and left for the Old North Church to find the railroad. That's right, I'm siding with the railroad this time. Actually, for the first time ever. Hopefully you all know the password for the railroad. It's in the name. They asked me some questions, I asked them some questions, and then Deacon vouched for me, which was awfully nice of him considering I don't know him at all. Either way, it was time to see if I had what it took to join the railroad for real by helping Deacon recover Dr. Carrington's prototype from the switchboard. Before that, I stopped back at Diamond City, watched a guy get shot, and gave Piper the interview of a lifetime so I could level up and pick the armor perk. I went back to Sanctuary to upgrade my armor and realized I didn't even have enough adhesive to do so, so I had to go to a few shops and even back into the waste to get some. I ran into my first legendary here, and to say the least, it didn't go very well. Lots of dying, but I eventually singled out the legendary and killed him and got some armor. I can say that for the first time, I'm glad I got some armor here since I could actually wear it, and even if it's not that good, it's better than nothing. I discovered Bunker Hill after that and bought the rest of what I needed from Deb, and went back to Sanctuary to finally upgrade my armor to the max, for whatever that's worth. I only ended up with 65 DT, which was not very good. It was about this time when I realized that that would be a staple of the whole challenge. Nothing I ever had would be that good. Slightly depressed that my character would suck for the majority of the game, I made my way to where Deacon was waiting for me so I could start the quest to gain access to the railroad at large. Pretty easy opening to the quest. Follow Deacon, kill some ghouls, talk to a guy, fall to your death on accident, make your way to the back entrance, and realize that there is no way you can do this quest in your current state. I am not a bullet sponge, or in this case, a laser sponge, and I was not going to be able to kill all of those synths without a lot of extra work and some more stimpaks and chems. So I loaded the save from before I found Deacon and decided to do a more simple quest, a Minutemen quest. On the way to the Corvega assembly plant, I made sure to clear out the Super Duper Mart and got a level which I used to get the Big League's perk to rank 2. Outside of Corvega, there were raiders and turrets. My one weakness in this challenge, god, they do so much damage. The inside of Corvega housed raiders as well, most of which I killed, unless they were guarded by turrets. The big bad boss raider was also a little difficult to kill because of, you guessed it, turrets. It was still a lot easier than killing synths, and I was done before I knew it. Before I returned to Preston, though, I stopped at Diamond City to do a little bartering. Preston told me the story of what happened to the Minutemen, and then made me a general, and I leveled up and picked the toughness perk, which would help a little bit with the whole constant dying thing. I still felt vastly underprepared for the switchboard, so I kept on doing some Minutemen quests for a while. Like this one. And this one. And this one, which was actually kinda hard because of the glowing one at the end. But I managed with only a few broken bones. I also killed a legendary ghoul and got an actual alright pipe pistol. I'd use that in a normal playthrough for a while at least, and this is where the game laughs in my face because we get a lot of better legendaries that I can't use down the line in this run. Back at Sanctuary, I went to the armor bench to upgrade combat armor chest piece that I got from a dead Brotherhood member inside of the National Guard place and decided against it so I could save my supplies for better upgrades later, and went to Diamond City to fuel my ever-growing chem addiction. The next Minutemen quest I was given was to go to Finch Farm and help them out, and I knew it was a bad idea. I just didn't realize how bad it would actually be until I was there getting burnt to a crisp. I stopped the Minutemen quest there and proceeded to go back to Deacon in hopes of being able to complete the Tradecraft quest. It was still really difficult, but I was also pumped full of chems, so it could have been much worse. With the prototype in my hand, I went to leave and got blown up by a cryomine like an idiot. I'll just avoid that this time. Back at the Railroad HQ, I was welcomed in as a new member and was given the codename Charmer, which is fitting for a man like me. I talked to Dr. Carrington about my next quest, which would require me to help a synth get to a safe place until he could get a new name and face. I also took Tinker Tom's shot, cause I ain't no wuss. The contact for the synth would be located at Bunker Hill, and when I met him, I played my role the Charmer all too well. He told me where the drop was gonna start and said that I would have to clear up before nightfall. Easy enough. Then I waited for nightfall for the package and waited for High Rise so we could start the delivery. There were some enemies located on roofs that I couldn't kill, but for the most part, it was a simple delivery. Back at HQ, I informed the doctor that the deed was done, and he asked me to check on the Augusta safehouse. I agreed, but decided to do some weather vane missions for Tinker Tom first. These gave me little experience, and were probably not worth it for how annoying it could be to find the spots to set Tom's device, especially when there were super mutants all over the damn place. After a few of those, I was told to talk to Pam so I could set up the Mercer safehouse, which I would, after I did a few more weather vane quests. I also found a freezing laser musket. Not bad at all. If I could actually use it. After that, I actually went to set up the Mercer safe house, which was as easy as cleaning it up a bit and throwing down a few turrets and a settler radio tower. Pam thanked me and told me of a secret Black Ops DIA cache located somewhere with goodies, and that was a very good thing. After I did one to two of these DIA caches, I would have access to ballistic weave for certain clothing items in the game, and that could change everything. I also leveled up to 12 here, so let's take a quick peek at some of my perks, and get the Idiot Savant perk while I'm at it. The DIA cache was located in an area that was home to a god-awful amount of super mutants. I'm not gonna lie, I didn't even bother attacking them at all. I think I can count on one hand the amount of super mutants I killed in this whole run. After a great deal of pain and running, I found the cache and left as fast as I could. I also took the time to do another weather vane quest for Tom. Hope you're happy, you crazy bastard. I went back to Diamond City for supplies and started up the Randolph Safehouse quest. I would have to go to the University Point and clear out all of the hostiles there. This would prove to be a challenge. The synths located here, not difficult to kill. The glowing Mire lurks though, that is a completely different story. Holy crap on a cracker, they were difficult. I figured if I could get past this one fast enough, I would be in the clear, but there was another one and a softshell one to boot. Eventually, out of sheer spite for this place, I emerged victorious and went back outside to clear the rest of the synths. Then it was back to Desdemona to finish the quest. Now it was time to check on Augusta Safehouse. I had to go to the dead drop, and the walk there was as peaceful as it could get, I suppose, and I arrived at Augusta in no time. This safehouse was filled with raiders. Not too hard, honestly. Oh, I just had to say it. Oh, I just had to say it, didn't I? After nursing my wounds and taking out my anger on a few ghouls, I returned to Dr. Carrington with the bad news that the safehouse was destroyed. There was also a Deathclaw there, but I kept that one for myself. It was now time for one last quest before I started the main one. Another DIA cache, which would hopefully net me access to Ballistic Weave. Do you like super mutants? Do you like when they blow themselves up because they have the brain the size of a squirrel? Do you like dying constantly because said super mutants can see through a stealth boy and kill you anyway? If you answered yes to all of those questions, what the hell is wrong with you? Long story short, this area was a pain in my ass, but I got the damn cash, and that's all that mattered. I was also able to finally, for the first time ever in a playthrough, be able to use Ballistic Weave. Seriously, I've never got this stuff before, even in a casual playthrough. The Railroad just always seems so boring compared to the other factions. I also have this new bowler hat, which works surprisingly well for my character. Now, for some reason, after I went through all of the trouble to get Ballistic Weave, I decided to not make use of it yet because I am a very stupid man. Instead, I went to Vault 81 for some supplies, and made a few rounds buying leather and ballistic fiber from Lucas Miller so I could increase my current armor, which was combat armor. Now I have 90 ballistic defense and 70 energy resistance. Not very good, but I guess that'll have to do because I am too stupid to get under armor that I can ballistic weave. Don't worry, I eventually do though. Now it was time for some main quests, like finding Nick Valentine. I met with his assistant Ellie and conned her into paying me money to find Nick. Apparently he was holed up somewhere in a vault nearby. After everything I just went through for the railroad, this was an absolute cakewalk. Sure, I still took plenty of damage, but I was able to clear out the triggermen like nobody's business in comparison to what I just went through. Once I arrived in the room where Nick was located, I gave Dino a good whoopin' and freed Nick from his confines. He thanked me, and together we cleared the rest of the vault of triggermen. Sadly, I definitely didn't have enough chems or stimpaks to take on Skinny Malone for real, so I just convinced his girl to leave him, which works just as well for me. Outside, Nick thanked me and told me to meet him at his place to discuss the finding of my son. And that's just what I plan to do. Right after I sold all of my stuff and bought as many chems and stimpaks as I could fit in my pockets. After that, I returned to Valentine Detective Agency and talked with Ellie. I'm just now realizing that my character kinda looks like an old-timey thug, and that's hilarious. Anyway, I sat down with Nick and discussed with him the murder of my wife and the kidnapping of my son. Apparently, he magically gleamed that the one guy I described was Kellogg and said he had a house in Diamond City, which, let's be honest, is way too unbelievable. Either way, we went there to find it locked and needing to plead with the mayor to get the key. Once inside, we found all the evidence we needed, and once again, Nick did his magic whistle and Dogmeat somehow made it from the Red Rocket truck stop to Diamond City in 20 seconds. Now it was time to follow Dogmeat to Fort Hagen, which is everyone's favorite part of the game. To getting the crap blown out of me by super mutants with rocket launchers, to fighting legendary dogs and bloatflies, the trip was as you expected it, just with lots more pool cue. We arrived and I sent Dogmeat away forever so I could make my way in on my own. Fort Hagen was filled with synths, as always, so I knew what to expect. A lot of chems and a lot of pool cue swinging. Aside from that, it was pretty easy. Except for this turret, which was way more overpowered than it had the right to be. Kellogg, as handsome as he is, was a complete pushover as usual. With bits of his cybernetic brain in my pocket, I left and was introduced to the Brotherhood of Steel, which I never had any good dealings with in this challenge. Back at Nick's place, I gave him the good news that Kellogg was beaten to death by a pool cue, and now our chances of finding my son were slim to none, but I still got to beat him with a stick, so it was worth it. We pondered for a moment until Nick realized that if we had his brain, we might be able to take it to Dr. Mari at the Memory Lounge and get it to sing for us, and even though the thought of Kellogg singing wasn't one I liked, I agreed and made my way there post-haste. Wow, going into the memories of a dead man sure is boring and really, really annoying after the 20th time of doing it. At least we got to figure out that the Institute uses teleportation technology to get inside and outside, and that one Dr. Virgil, a rogue Institute scientist, might be able to help us reverse engineer it. Sadly, he was located in the Glowing Sea, and that was a very bad place for me to go with just a pool cue. I also leveled up to 17 here, so let's take a gander at some of my perks. The walk to the Glowing Sea had me fighting legendary mongrels to get a freezing walking cane. Why couldn't that be a pool cue? I always seem to get legendary pool cues in casual playthroughs all the damn time, why not now? On the edge of the Glowing Sea, I fought some ghouls, and deeper in, I fought some more, including a legendary that dropped this decent pair of knuckles. Like, seriously, what the hell is wrong with this game today? I made it to the crater, none the worse for wear, and talked to the crazed cultists about Virgil, who was apparently living in a cave not too far from them. Good. Just gonna ignore that Deathclaw on the way in. Virgil was not too happy to see me, but I also killed Kellogg, so I guess that kinda evens it out a little. I told him I needed help to get into the Institute, and he said he could, if I helped him by getting the serum he needed to return to normal. Totally, big guy. Apparently, I needed to kill a courser and get its chip, which wasn't easy, and I imagine that was a true statement for once. I walked over to the CIT ruins and started following the radio signal to Green Tech Genetics. I lied. I just walked to it. As soon as I stepped in, I had an epiphany. I was going to get every ounce of my fecal matter pushed back inside of me if I didn't have enough armor, so it was time to head back to Sanctuary and get some ballistic weave fitted on my clothing. The bad thing is that I can't ballistic weave my road leathers without a mod, and I didn't really want to do that, so I had to ditch them for some military fatigues, which worked out alright in the end. This was also the end of the bowler hat as well, seeing as I could armor a battered fedora and get even more armor. I had to head back to Park Street Station to loot one from a dead Triggerman, but it was worth it, I guess, because I now had 245 ballistic defense and 243 energy resistance. I also found this wonderful message from some crazy guy who has way too much time on his hands. I feel like maybe we should do what he says, so he continues to do stupidly amusing things. Now that I was heavily armored, I went back to Green Tech Genetics, and oh my sweet god, oh lord, this is so much better. I can actually take damage and not die stupidly fast. It also helped that I could knock enemies' weapons out of their hands, but this was also annoying occasionally, as they often blocked or hit me while I was winding up my attacks. Still, very handy. When I made it to the top, I was expecting a decent fight, but what I got was a courser stuck in the corner for being a bad boy. I also killed the rest of the gunners and freed the synth from her confines, and left to get the chip decoded by my buddies at the Railroad HQ. Desdemona had a nice little meeting about the Brotherhood and why they are our enemies, and then Tom decoded the chip for me so I could return to Virgil. Let's cut to the chase. Virgil has the plans all mapped out to the best of his ability, and don't worry, buddy, I won't forget your serum. So where did you say you got these plans? No, I can't remember. The Railroad agreed to help me build the device, and I would have to do so at Red Rocket Truck Stop / Mercer Safe House. The base platform was easy enough, but getting the other components was also very easy. Except for the sensor module, as I never seem to have one by this point in the game, and I never see them for sale for some reason. I had to get one from a super mutant infested area, which was terrifying, but I managed to get back in one piece and completed the teleportation device. Now was time to infiltrate the Institute and make contact with Patriot, an Institute member who has been helping synths escape for a very long time, but we don't know who they are, so I was to place a holotape in a computer and send out a coded message for them that only they could understand. Once inside, I found my robot son, and then my real son. Unlike most of my playthroughs, my character is much more forgiving, so after a very short adjustment period, he accepts that his son is much older than him, and still very much loves him. He just loves freeing synths from their chains of tyranny even more. I agreed to help him, while he hopefully had no idea that I was working undercover. Then I proceeded to send Patriot the message from Father's Terminal, and got a reply back nearly instantly. I was told to meet them in a secure area, in the storage closet. It was Liam Binet, and he had a plan to help me free at least 13 synths, but he had to introduce me to Z-114 first. After discussing the plans, I was told if they were to work, I would need to get Liam a secure login for a very old set of terminals. Sounded easy enough, and from there I met with the rest of the scientists I had to, and left for the Railroad HQ to discuss my findings. Apparently it wouldn't be as easy as I thought, as the sign-in ID and password were located at Cambridge Polymer Labs, which sounds relatively safe, but a crazed robot locks you in until you finish the work that was supposed to be done 200-odd years ago. It wasn't really too bad, it just took me by surprise. I'm also starting to realize just how much of Fallout 4 I've missed by not doing side quests often. Oh well. The place was infested with ghouls, which were easy, and getting all of the supplies I needed to make the compound to leave was also easy, but actually, making the compound was a little more difficult. I also stopped at a chemistry bench to make chems, and realized I had done something horribly wrong. I wasn't making Fury, which would boost melee damage by 50%. I wouldn't be able to without a lot of points in intelligence, and that would just ruin my idiot savant thing I had going, so I guess I'll just chalk it up to bad research on my part. Sorry. I threw the proper elements into the machine and made the compound, and I got a piece of power armor in return, which was useless. At least I got the ID and password though prior to this, which meant I had something worthwhile. Back at HQ, Desdemona and I discussed rescuing all of the synths rather than just the 13 that Liam wanted to rescue. I agreed with this, and it was now time to get Liam out of the picture. By talking to Z-114 about the new plan and giving Liam the ID and password and not telling him a thing about the new plan. He'll still do what needs to be done without knowing. Back to Z-1, he asked me to stage an accident in an area that was currently being mined so they would be able to get their hands on some weapons to fight when the time came. So I went in and knocked a few synths around and returned to Z-1. Now it was time to wait until the perfect opportunity came to escape, and in the meantime I was to continue working with Father and the Institute. My first real quest for the Institute would be to bring in a rogue synth from the Raider Camp Libertalia, and that would be easy enough since he was sending a courser to help me. On the way there, I fought my toughest enemy yet, a legendary Mirelurk Killclaw. This bad boy took quite a few wallops from my pool cue before he died, and I got a really nice revolutionary sword from him. Too bad, it's not a pool cue. I also fought a legendary raider, and I got a really nice hunting rifle. It's still not a pool cue. Getting sick of these good legendaries said no one ever but me. After getting depressed by two legendaries, I trotted through Libertalia not really caring if I got exploded by some mini-nukes and made my way to the top to deal with the synth. I told him I was after his loot and convinced him to give me some, but the courser that was sent with me was a party pooper and didn't let me have any fun. With that done, I could return to Father and get my next quest, the Battle of Bunker Hill. There were some escaped synths there and they needed to return home, but since I'm with the Railroad, I returned to Desdemona and told her of the battle that was about to unfold. She told me my new objective was to secure the synths and kill the courser accompanying me and return to Father with the news of a lost battle. Seems easy enough, right? Well, no, not really. Now is when we get introduced to the Brotherhood of Steel for real, and they are not happy to see me. Battling anyone in power armor was very challenging since they were tanks, and there were more than one of them. Of course, once I knocked the weapons out of their hands, it could have been worse. There were more of them in the basement area, and thankfully, I had more railroad support down here. When I made it to the last room, I told the synths not to worry and proceeded to knock the tar out of the courser with my trusty pool cue. It was time to return to Father with the bad news. He was on the roof of the CIT ruins for some reason, causing me to enter and put down the only super mutants of the challenge. He wasn't too happy about my failure, but he also said it was time for a director's meeting. Oh no, Father is dying and he's putting me in charge. Not really the smartest move on his part, was it? The whole board of directors was pretty pissed, but life goes on. Now it was time to go to Mass Fusion and get the beryllium agitator so the Institute could start their nuclear generator. Doing this would cause the Brotherhood to permanently be my enemy, which was fine, aside from the stupid amount of them that wear power armor. Mass Fusion was more or less the same as always, except with copious amounts of pool queuing. The only thing that was a nightmare was after I retrieved the agitator. Killing a sentry bot with a pool queue is very, very hard. He has miniguns and large robo-fists, I have stick with knife. Go ahead and calculate the odds. I'll wait. Oh, are they not very good? Who would have thought? After I killed it miraculously, I was greeted by two Assaultrons, which I classify as worse than a sentry bot. So much running, so much jet, and many, many whacks with my pool cue later, and I was victorious. Somehow. Please never attempt this, it's so goddamn bad. At least I got to take out my anger on some Brotherhood members before I left to give the agitator to Allie. Getting kinda long, so let's keep the rest short with some quick, timed, witty humor. The next quest entails me halting a standoff against my Minutemen and a few Institute scientists who were trying to convince another scientist to join them. My sweet charm settled the whole thing rather quickly, and then I gave a speech to the Commonwealth that I thought was pretty good, and I was told that I had to go to Diamond City and fix up the radio station equipment there so everyone could hear it. There we go, right as rain. Back at the Institute, I plugged in the agitator, and behold, power beyond your wildest dreams. Another director meeting about destroying the railroad this time. I don't want to do it, son. They're my friends. Do it. Z1 informs me that the Brotherhood is about to attack the railroad. Better get there fast, and after that, it's time for the big escape. Oh hey, you're all still alive. Yeah, what do you mean? Do you smell xenophobic asshole? Die, die, die! Oh no, Glory is dead. I swear to God, just die already, you armor-clad asshats. Whoa, he exploded his fusion core and got out of the armor mid-battle. That's never happened before. Oh well, less armor means less pool cue swings. Ah! No one can challenge me, I am a god! Oh hey, kinda got carried away there, what's up? Vertibirds and more armored hooligans. Oh, I'm game. Better be careful, might poke your eye out. How am I supposed to do that? Go, Deacon, go! Go, Deacon, go! Nice work, buddy. Let's hope Tom knows how to fly this thing. Nope, didn't think so. Disguises and bombs? Now we're talking. Hey, what are you doing here? Did Scribe Halen send that crap along I needed? I wasn't there? No. Like, for real, I wasn't there. No. She forgot it? Yeah, okay. One bomb!
Hey, restricted area, bub.
I'm new?
Get the fuck out of my sight, rookie.
Two bombs! Oh hell, my disguise failed. Three bombs! Go, go, go! God, you suck, Tom!
Explosion shakes downtown Boston!
It's revolution time, baby, and I'm gonna dismantle this establishment one swing at a time. Sup, bros? More explosions? Two in one day? Oh heck yeah. Bonk! It's Magilla Gorilla! Oh god, hope you didn't need that. Son, are you sick? Eat a bag of dicks. Hey. Wanna help me by telling me the synth deactivation code? What the hell? No! You know I can beat you to death with this pool cue, right? It's 9003, asshole. Okay, bye! I'm just gonna put that there. Voila, time to explode. Hello, Papa, please love me. Well, I guess it's okay since I'm in the railroad. And I beat Fallout 4 using only a pool cue. How was that for an ending, huh? Let me know if you liked it in the comments, and let me know if you hated it as well. This challenge was the longest challenge I have ever done, clocking in at around 20-ish hours. Don't do this, please, for the love of God, never attempt this. This is not fun. It is pain for your enjoyment. I will say that I have a newfound love for the railroad, though, which I guess is a good thing. If you enjoyed today's video, make sure to subscribe and like, as that helps me out bunches. Also, check out some of my other challenges, I'm sure you'll like those too. I'll leave links to my Discord and Patreon for those interested. A huge thank you to my patrons, Braden Watson, Deus Sicorum, Riley Anderson, Jamie East, and Untamed Pineapple. Y'all are the best. And a very special thank you to my Discord friend, Billy Joel, for buying me Xbox Game Pass when mine ran out and my Fallout 4 disc wouldn't work. So thank you very much, Billy Joel. And until next time, stay safe out there, and peace out.